It is 9 p.m. Central, and it is time at Rethought Blog's Conscience 2 for the Godless Perverts Story Hour. Take it away, folks.
Hello, San Francisco. Can you guys hear us okay? Yay!
And hello, Internet. Can you guys hear us okay?
Hello, world. We can't hear you, but we assume you're there. Welcome to Godless Pervert Story Hour. For the first time on the planet Earth, live streamed on the FtBCon to the planet Earth.
Yay!
Hello, world. So, we are live at the Sex and Center, the Center for Sex and Culture in beautiful, vivacious San Francisco. Welcome to our virtual audience as well as our live one. After the readings, there will be a Q&A panel for all our 7 authors, and we welcome questions from our online readers as well, our audience as well. If you're watching us from the internet, go to ftbcon.org, click on Ferangula Chat on the right-hand side under Very Important Links to talk about the event and ask questions. The live audience will not be recorded unless you want to come up for Q&A.
A quick bit of housekeeping. You probably guessed this because this is the Godless Pervert Story Hour. But I think the people in the live audience know this, but for people in the online audience in particular, this event is about sex, and that means a couple of things. First of all, this event is about sex, and that means if you are under 18, please hang up now. This event is for adults only. It's awesome if you are a super sex-educated, sexually sophisticated teenager. You still can't watch this. Wait till you're 18. We're recording it, and then you can watch it on YouTube. You'll still see it. The other bit of housekeeping is that we are going to be talking about sex. We're going to be talking very explicitly about sex. We're going to be talking about, possibly talking about varieties of sex and sexual experiences that some people may find unsettling or disturbing. If you are unsettled or disturbed and don't want to watch anymore, we encourage you to take yourself out of the audience. We will not think less of you. We'll actually think more of you because, hey, you're setting boundaries well. We like that.
No judgment.
But just be aware of that. You know, this is hardcore, porny, porn.
Super sexy, sex up sex.
Do you want to talk about the history very
briefly? Yeah. Just where did this come from? Most of the people here in the audience have probably heard this story before, but for you who are just turning in from the internet, from Burkina Faso or Uzbekistan, may not know that... this is Greta Christina, atheist activist and erotica writer. My name is Dave Fitzgerald, atheist activist and also erotica writer on the side. Funny story, one day you have two atheist activists / erotica writers in San Francisco airport on our way to an atheist event, and we got this idea that, hey, isn't it funny that we're erotica writers and atheist activists, and, you know, cut to the chase, you got your peanut butter in my chocolate in my peanut butter, and we said we should get these things together. And
And Chris Hall, who unfortunately you can't see tonight,
Chris,
who is doing tech. Thank you so much for doing tech tonight, Chris.
Woo-hoo, Chris!
Chris Hall had already started doing Godless Perverts events. He'd done a panel discussion, and so the three of us got together, and lo and behold, the miracle that is the Godless Perverts.
The Trinity gave a love baby, and it's this right here, Godless Pervert Story Hour.
Do you want to talk about the posters real quick?
Yeah. The posters, we have a catalog here. Courtesy of Carol Queen from the Center for Sex and Culture. All these posters are for sale.
No, they're not.
The
posters are not for sale.
The posters are not for sale.
Why don't I talk about the posters?
Let's do that.
Okay. So here's the deal. The posters that you see behind you are part of Buzz Bentz's Safer Sex poster collection of well over 100, 150, I think, Safer Sex posters from throughout the history of safe sex education. And the Center for Sex and Culture has a catalog of this collection. It is titled Safe Sex Bang, and you can get it on the Center for Sex and Culture website. And if you're here physically, you can get it at the counter.
That table right over there.
So yeah, so if you're wondering why this is what it is, that's why it is what it is.
There you go.
All right, should we get started?
I think we do need to get started because we've got a big 2 full hours of exciting story hour. Our first speaker, you may be surprised to know, is Greta Christina, who has been writing professionally since 1989 on topics including atheism, sexuality, sex positivity, LGBT issues, politics, culture, and whatever crosses her mind. She's on the Speakers Bureau for the Secular Student Alliance and the Center for Inquiry. She is the editor of the Best Erotic Comics Anthology series and Paying for It, A Guide to Sex Workers for Their Clients. Her writing has appeared in multiple magazines and newspapers, including Ms., Penthouse, Chicago Sun-Times, On Our Backs, Skeptical Inquirer, and numerous anthologies including Everything You Know About God Is Wrong and 3 volumes of Best American Erotica. Her most recent book is Why Are You Atheists So Angry? 99 Things That Piss Off the Godless, a book that every atheist out there should be buying and reading. She lives in San Francisco with her lovely wife Ingrid, who's right there. There she is. You can email her at greta@gretachristina.com and follow her on Twitter at Greta Christina. Ladies and gentlemen, and everyone else, Greta Christina.
Hi, thank you so much for that kind introduction, which I wrote myself several months ago, apparently, because I neglected to mention that I have a new book out. It's called Bending, Dirty Kinky Stories About Pain, Power, Religion, Unicorns, and More. It's a porny, porny, porn, porn book. That's available in ebook and audiobook, prints coming soon. And my new book is coming out in April. It is called Coming Out Atheist, How to Do It, How to Help Each Other, and Why. But that's not what I'm talking about today. Today I am talking about the sex. And this is a piece that I just wrote. I wrote it specifically for the Godless Perverts Story Hour. It's called To Give Itself Pleasure. We are a way for the universe to give itself pleasure. There's a famous quote by Carl Sagan. Well, famous among atheists and skeptics and other people who think of Carl Sagan as super famous. There's this quote by Carl Sagan, we are a way for the cosmos to know itself. And yes, that is A, true, and B, mega cool. We are how the universe knows itself. 13.7 billion years ago, the universe went foom, and it's gone through countless configurations since then. And one of those configurations, one that's happening right here and right now, is conscious life. Not just conscious life, but conscious, curious, exploring life that's capable of looking around and carefully examining what it perceives and sorting out better ideas from worse ones and figuring out what exactly is going on out there. The matter and energy of the universe has been morphing and morphing and morphing, and right now it's morphed into a state that is capable, in a small way, of understanding itself. This makes me so happy. Yes, the universe is amazing, but without conscious life, the universe has no way of knowing just how amazing it is. It has no way of experiencing amazement. We are the experience, not only of knowledge, but of amazement at that knowledge. We are a minuscule piece of the matter and energy of the universe, looking carefully at some of the rest of the matter and energy, and saying, wow! Really? Black holes? Moving continents? All life on the planet sharing a common ancestor? Are you freaking kidding me? That is wicked cool. But we aren't just that. We aren't just a way for the universe to know itself. We are a way for the universe to give itself pleasure. For 13.7 billion years, the universe has gone through countless configurations. And one of those configurations is a configuration not just of consciousness, not just of knowledge, but of ecstasy. When we come, we are shifting the matter and energy of the universe into the form of euphoric, all-encompassing pleasure. When we fuck, when we suck, when we lick, when we finger, when we spank, when we pierce, when we tie each other up, when we masturbate, when we make good porn and enjoy good porn, when we dress up like saloon girls or ponies or 1950s biker gangs, we are the universe getting itself off. Take a moment. Really appreciate that. We are not just how the universe knows itself. We are how the universe enjoys itself. A friend of mine has a nerdy t-shirt that says, serotonin and dopamine, technically the only two things you enjoy. It made me chuckle, and then, me being me, I started to analyze and quibble. And I replied, well, if you're going to get technical about it, serotonin and dopamine aren't things you enjoy. Technically, serotonin and dopamine are your enjoyment. Enjoyment is a particular set of configurations of the goop inside our skulls. I know that many people find this view of human experience depressing, cold, mechanical, reductionist. But for me, it's exactly the opposite. Chemicals turned into different chemicals, which turned into different chemicals. And eventually, over billions of years, they turned into chemicals that generate joy. And we aren't just capable of experiencing our own pleasure. We're capable of experiencing each other's. We're capable of giving each other orgasms and taking pleasure from them. We're capable of fingering each other's pussies and sucking each other's dicks and spanking each other's asses and having it flood our own brains with the chemicals of joy. As much as we are hungry for our own pleasure, we are also capable of being desperately, feverishly hungry for each other's. We are a minuscule piece of the matter and energy of the universe, looking carefully at some of the rest of the matter and energy and saying, how would you like to get off? I love that this is how life perpetuates itself. I love that one of the chief ways that evolution works is that the experience of survival and reproduction is a pleasurable one. Life, almost by definition, is that which survives and reproduces. And I love that one of the central mechanisms by which this happens is that for hundreds of millions of years, survival and reproduction have felt deeply, intensely, overwhelmingly good. And I love that we've taken this powerful evolutionary drive to reproduce and have taken ownership of it. I love that we've taken this drive and have said, sure, this was once about reproduction, and sometimes it still is, but it doesn't have to be. This can be about anything we want. I love that we've dressed it up in studs and feathers, boots and stockings, that we've added personal theater and public theater, that we've spent millennia exploring it in painting and writing and film and pixels. I love that we've taken this drive and used it to turn pain into ecstasy, shame into intimacy, helplessness into adventure, power into trust. I love that we've blended this drive with our uniquely human ability to make and use tools in the form of dildos and vibrators and butt plugs and floggers and condoms and lube and violet wands and things that I don't even know what they are. I love that we've blended this drive with our uniquely human ability to learn and explore and understand in the form of books and videos and workshops and research papers and blog posts about anatomy and sociology and psychology and sexology, about birth control and the psychological health of homosexuality, and how exactly you tie someone to the bed. I love that we've blended this drive with our uniquely human ability to precisely communicate through language. So we can say to each other, what I like is feathers and boots and floggings and vibrators and getting tied to the bed. What do you like? I love that we've taken this powerful evolutionary drive and have transformed it into expressions of love, friendship, companionship, consolation, community, art. In the words of Darwin, although not about this subject exactly, endless forms most beautiful. And in the same way that I fall into rage and despair over people who deny their capacity to understand the universe because they think their God forbids it, I sometimes fall into rage and despair over people who deny their capacity to experience pleasure, harmless, honest, entirely ethical pleasure because they think their God forbids it. In the same way that I fall into rage and despair over people whose religion leads them to not only deny their own capacity for knowledge, but to suppress other people's, I fall into rage and despair over people whose religion leads them to suppress other people's capacity for pleasure. It makes me rage and despair to think that there are people who are taking their one short life, their minuscule sliver of matter and energy, and are devoting it to denying reality and obstructing joy. Because they've been taught that this is necessary in order to experience an invisible, inaudible, intangible world that nobody has ever shown any good reason to think even exists. It makes me rage and despair to think that we have such a short time to create understanding and ecstasy, and there are people who are actively devoting their lives to throwing up roadblocks. But I mostly don't want to talk about rage and despair today. I want to acknowledge it, I want to recognize it, and let it motivate me to make things better, and I want to move on. My own sliver of matter and energy is small and getting smaller. As they might be giants saying, I'm older than I've ever been, and now I'm even older, and now I'm even older, and now I'm even older. I have a small sliver, and I want to devote part of that sliver to demolishing the roadblocks to pleasure. But I also want to devote it to experiencing pleasure and appreciating it. We have a minuscule sliver of matter and energy. We are an infinitesimal eye blink in the vastness of time and space. But in that eye blink, we get to be the universe giving itself pleasure. We get to be chemicals that generate joy. That is extraordinary. That is amazing. So let's take a moment and arrange the goop inside our skulls into the configuration of amazement and let ourselves be amazed. Thank you.
Rock on. All right, our next speaker, Virgie Tovar, is an author, activist, and one of the nation's leading experts and lecturers on fat discrimination and body image. She's the editor of Hot and Heavy, Fierce Fat Girls on Life, Love, and Fashion. She holds a master's degree in human sexuality with a focus on the intersections of body size, race, and gender. She's been featured by MTV, the San Francisco Chronicle, Bust Magazine, and Jezebel, as well as on Women's Entertainment Television and The Ricky Lake Show. She's a babely, multiracial femme, and uppity apostate who lives in San Francisco. Find her online at www.virgietovar.com. Virgie, come on up. Woo!
So, actually, this piece ended up leading to a lot of realizations around colonialism and the way the church kind of plays a role in that for me. So I'm going to start it, and we can talk about it afterwards during the Q&A. I spent nearly 20 years in a Pentecostal church in El Sobrante, California, a town 20 miles from right here, whose name literally translates to the leftovers. By 12, I had excused myself from all youth-related activities and was the head Sunday school teacher and volunteered every Sunday to run the projector that magnified all the hymns onto a big screen so everyone in the church could sing before the sermon. This put me in close proximity to the pastor, the head deacon, and the choir director, Brother David. The members of the church thought I was precocious, and I convinced myself that I did these things because I was a good girl and a good Christian. But really, I preferred the inappropriate intimacies that my young, fat, brown body inspired in the fathers over the disgust it inspired in their sons. So I dressed up for them, and I went on diets for them, and I wore perfume for them, and I did my hair for them, and I burned for them, the way a fat brown girl learns to burn for white men and their churches and their secrets, and they get hard from the knowledge that you have nowhere else to go. They keep you there with bones, and somehow you lose your appetite for meat. The church was headed by the pastor, but it was run by a multi-generational family whose patriarch was a 6-foot-tall sheriff who hailed from Texas. He had 2 sons. One who was just like him, hard, practical, a fireman who married young and spoke little, and the other who was alleged to have a prodigal son story and who loved to sing. Brother David had a beautiful voice, a gift he believed God had endowed him to bring people closer to him, closer to God, that is. Brother David was married to a woman named Phyllis. Though Phyllis had been previously married to a non-believer, Brother David figured he couldn't really blame her because he did bear a striking resemblance to Kenny Rogers, whom he thought of as handsome and talented, and who he understood rightfully had a special power over Republican women of a certain age. She also had 3 blonde children from this man, and beneath her foundation and blush burned a shame that David knew, and that made him want her. Phyllis had big brown eyes and large breasts she kept modestly cloaked. He saw in her the same hardness he saw in his father, and it exhilarated and terrified him. She attended church every Sunday without fail with her three blonde children dressed in bows and button downs, so he knew that she would make a good wife. Brother David needed a good wife, a good Christian wife. Like Phyllis, Brother David had a past of his own and knew that without a good, strong woman to keep him on the righteous path, he was capable of behaviors he hated to remember. He knew it wasn't entirely fair to use women in this way, but felt that the alternative was far worse. He would commit himself to Phyllis just like any normal man would. No one would know the difference. And what more could the world, Phyllis, or even God ask of him? Phyllis wore silk blouses, white slips, polyester business skirts, and navy pumps she'd gotten at Neiman's once on sale 7 years before. She kept them in their box, and they made her feel a sense of superiority. At church, she crossed her legs in a way such that the small black print of the manufacturer showed, so the other women would notice. She wore perfume, too. Though the scent was a knockoff from Long's drugstore, she told Brother David it was Chanel No. 5. On their first date, which was at Outback Steakhouse, she introduced him to ribeye that night. He couldn't believe how delicious it was, and he took it as an auspicious sign that they would be well-suited together. Brother David had never seen a more tastefully appointed woman in his 27 years. He knew she was older and that other men in the church were probably vying for her hand now that Kenny Rogers was out of the picture. But he thought that maybe his voice and his position as the choir director uniquely positioned him as a particularly competitive candidate. He had prayed every night for weeks, asking God for wisdom in the matter of asking Phyllis on a date. Lord, he prayed, let your will be done. I do nothing without your blessing. Phyllis gave Brother David very strong erections, which he alleviated with three aggressive flicks to the head of his penis. He could do this through his choir robes and the few moments alone he had in the choir room after the choir, his choir, had filed out, each giving Brother David a high five and a grin before the pastor introduced him and he jogged on stage with his hands high above his head, outstretched in praise, his headset securely on as he whispered, as if unintentionally, as if you were unexpectedly witnessing an intimate moment, "Hallelujah," again and again. Brother David hadn't masturbated in 11 months when he married Phyllis. He had made a divine promise, an exchange of sorts, to be celibate. He believed that the semen he held inside him was the key to staying on the right path. It held all of his virtue, his good self, his new self. It protected him from sin and wrath and impure desires. His semen belonged to God now. I'm sorry, if anybody else is a Pentecostal, they know that I'm not lying about any of this. Until recently, Brother David had been, among other things, an avid masturbator. He woke up at 4, 5, 6 in the morning, his hand wrapped around his dick, looking for a scene even more nasty than the last one on his computer. College boys sucking multiple cocks, licking men's assholes, older men forcing girls to drink piss out of their own pussies with a long winding straw. He would jack off until he was sweating and crying, chafed, and wishing he weren't him, wishing he weren't a pervert, sometimes wishing he weren't alive. When he found the Lord's Children's Church in the phone book, he was relieved and excited and nauseous. He spent a week masturbating to the thought of co-eds praying and then sucking his cock before he called the Lord's Children's Church. The secretary answered and he asked if there was an open position for choir director. The secretary replied that yes, they had been praying for this very phone call. Anne confessed, coquettishly, that she felt his name was all the reference she needed. Anyone whose mother had the good sense to name him after one of the Bible's greatest kings was good stock as far as she was concerned. He could hear her pussy engorging in the sound of her voice. He swore he could smell it through the phone. Saliva flooded her mouth, her tongue swelling until each word sounded like a big cock going in and out of a well-lubricated cunt. He asked her over and they fucked. In his tiny cluttered bedroom with the broken fan and the dozen empty Budweiser bottles and the gold cross around her neck slapped up and down on her huge tits as she rode him hissing King David over and over. Through her teeth as he tweaked her nipples. He had had a hard time getting erect and kept falling out of her. Her lips were sparkly and sticky with prepubescent style lip gloss, the kind named Bumbleberry or Tickle Melon you get from the dollar store on San Pablo Avenue. He stared at them, imagining them wrapped around a half dozen 12-inch cocks, imagining her throat opening up, her jaw unhinging like a python, to take more and more cock. Feeling the prickly hairs around her asshole finally made him come. She picked up his beer bottles afterwards, made him a sandwich, and asked if he had a girlfriend. He began crying, and she put one of her big tits in his mouth. He stared at the cross as her hand worked his flaccid cock. He decided he needed to find a new church. Renewed Encounters Church was in the next town. It was the church he'd grown up in, his father's church. They hadn't spoken in a long time. He tried to fuck the secretary from Renewed Encounters too, but when he opened the door to let her in, she wasn't there. A large man, the pastor of Renewed Encounters, it turned out, was. They shook hands. Pastor Tim was his name, and he was the new pastor, recently relocated from Tennessee with one goal: to save souls. And then the big bald man with an enormous chest and red mustache slapped Brother David hard across the face. Brother David fell back, and this man walked inside and closed the door. "I know who you are, David. In the name of Jesus, evil spirit, remove yourself from this place, from this Lamb of God." He slapped him again and again as he prayed and asked, "Are you ready to give up your life of sin, your fornication, your filthy onanism, your desire to please only yourself? Are you ready to become a disciple? For I am a fisher of men, David, and God has sent me here today to catch you." Pickup line. Okay, so Pastor Tim sat on top of Brother David, wrestling him, holding him down, looking him straight in the eyes, and then flipping him over onto his belly. "You're a snake, Brother David, a snake. Like that in the Garden of Eden who tries to make others crawl on their bellies like you." Pastor Tim's mouth was right next to Brother David's ear. He was pushing his nose into a puddle of semen near his bed. "Do you smell that, boy? You like to soil the carpet like a dog." "Well, I'll treat you like a dog. But God made you in his image, and you can inherit his kingdom if you say yes to me right now. You've got one chance. No one's coming for you after I leave. Your father doesn't care if you burn in hell, David. He told me he doesn't even consider you his son. But I came for you because I love you. Are you ready to be born again?" he asked over and over again into his ear until Brother David grabbed hold of Pastor Tim, crying into his gray suit jacket, "Yes, yes, yes." Brother David didn't know whether he loved Phyllis, but he knew that he loved the son that the two of them created. He represented the new life that Pastor Tim had given him. He knew he liked being able to have orgasms without any worry about backsliding. But they had sex less frequently than Phyllis desired, because Pastor Tim had advised him that the Bible is clear on the matter of women's insatiable erotic appetites. They are the fastest way to losing your way as a man. He must remember the tale of the snake, the fall. Pastor Tim visited his and Phyllis's home every Sunday night. They prayed together. They ate the roast or steak or sloppy joes that Phyllis made. Pastor Tim told jokes he had downloaded onto his phone from an app called Preacher Puns. Tim played with their new baby and asked after his oldest stepson. And after every dinner, Pastor Tim took Brother David for a drive and reminded him of that day when God compelled him to save his soul. Thank you.
That was beautiful. You're a bad, bad lady, Virgie. Oh, speaking of bad, Simon Sheppard is the damned to hell author and editor of 9 books about sex, including Kinkorama, Sodomy, Homosex, The Dirty Boys Club, and the forthcoming Man on Man, The Best of Simon Sheppard. winner of the Lambda Literary Award and the Erotica Writers Association Award. He's also published work in over 300 anthologies and periodicals, and he's the curator and co-host of the notorious Perverts Put Out performance series. Please welcome Simon Sheppard.
And come visit me at www.simonsheppard.com. This is the beginning of a longer piece. It's called The Tibetan Book of the Fag. Hail to thee, O nobly born, as you move through the bardo, heading toward the clear white light of nothingness. Remember that everything you encounter, both the friendly gods and the angry demons, is merely a creation of your mind. Cling not to your ego, for it's all an illusion. Cling rather to the great emptiness, O nobly born. Progress through the bardo of the anxious newbie. Following your desires, you once again arrange to be spanked by a stranger from Craigslist. As the moment approaches, you're about to forget about the whole thing, as you've always done before. Your mentor-to-be has nothing but your temporary email address and a blurry picture of your ass. But this time you give in to your desires and you head across town to your certain doom. His apartment smells like yesterday's hamburger, and he's lied about his age and weight. But none of that prevents an erection from forming in your pants. You follow him into his dimly lit bedroom. Pull down your pants, the stranger says, impatient, and get over my knees. You may not find him attractive, but he certainly knows his business. As you grind your erection into his still-clothed thigh, he slaps you, first one ass cheek, then the other, over and over with increasing ferocity. He is Yahweh, the God who punishes, and it hurts. It hurts a lot. He knows when to hold back, when to rain down a ritual of abuse. He knows when you're about to come, and you do come, right on schedule. When he shows you out the door, there's a spreading stain on Yahweh's pants. None of it has gone quite the way you'd pictured it, and as you walk down the strangely sparkling sidewalk, you're not sure how you feel, except sore. Be neither ashamed nor proud. Your progress to the light has begun. Enter the bardo of the leather bar. It draws you in, pulling you by the swollen tip of your desire, dimly lit and noisy, with more disco playing than would seem appropriate for such a butch place. It is hellish, or heavenly, or both. You are, or so it seems, surrounded by gods, deities clad in leather, bearded like Zeus. You are surrounded by your dreams, yet as the night wears on and you, frozen by fear, shrink into the shadows, it becomes a nightmare. Trapped still by your ego, you, O nobly born, are horny as fuck. Screwing up your courage, you head for the back room. It's dark in there, nearly pitch black, just the watery light of an exit sign. The room is full of men and lust and the odor of sour sweat. A hand grabs you, then another, and you're helpless, almost as helpless as you need to be. Your dick is extracted from your pants, hands reach up under your t-shirt, and all you want is a dick between your lips. This is the bardo of Shiva, many-armed god of extinction and rebirth. You are forced to your knees, though the word forced implies you resist, which you don't. Someone slaps your face, and you think back to Yahweh's spanking. Then a dick rubs up against your cheek, and you open your mouth wide. The dick fills your mouth and becomes all of your world. The stiff cock plunges deeper, nearly as deep as your hunger, and now you're gasping for breath. You want to gag, but you don't let yourself. Unsteady on your knees, you keep sucking, even if you wanted to back off. A firm hand on your head would prevent you. Just when you think you'll black out, fall over on the sticky floor, the man grunts only once and shoots his sperm generously down your throat. You've gotten what you're coming for, and you head back out into the night. A man with burning eyes comes up to you, stares deep into what passes for your soul, and reaches for your nipple. He twists it hard, harder than you like, in fact, but you don't object. He stands so close that you can smell his sour chemical breath, and he reaches around to your ass. No one has ever done this sort of thing in public to you before, but you don't stop him. He strokes your butt, then slaps it. "Let me take you home and beat the shit out of you," he says. In pain, you simply nod. You resolve to follow him anywhere. "My truck is down that alley," the man says, giving your nipple one last vicious tweak, a pain that shoots straight to your crotch. You follow him down the street. Clearly, you have entered some new, unknown to you, Bardo, the land of no shame. The man lives in a so-so part of the suburbs outside the edge of town. He parks the truck in his garage and leads you inside. His house is a mess. He peels off his worn leather vest, unzips his fly, and sits in a fairly ugly chair. "Kneel down," he commands you. His voice sounds more unsteady than it did out on the street. You kneel. "Take out my cock." You do. It's long, thin, uncut, and hasn't been washed recently. "What are you waiting for? Suck." You want things to be more ceremonial. You were hoping for something involving pain, not just shaky dominance. But things are what they are, in this house, everywhere. You get to work, trying to deep-throat him for what is, after all, an awkward angle. While your face is buried in his denim-clad crotch, he starts rummaging around on the table beside him, doing who knows what. Well, part of you knows, or at least strongly suspects, having previously spotted what was sitting on the tabletop, a butane lighter, a glass pipe, white powder, and a tiny plastic bag. He thrusts upward. You try not to gag. At just that second, there's a sound of a tiny torch being fired up, the sound of inhalation and exhalation of chemical smoke. Your companion is smoking meth. "You want some?" he asks, a generous host. You don't take your mouth off his dick. Don't try to say anything. He cuffs the back of your head hard. "I asked if you want some." You do want some, and you don't. You smoked crystal a couple of times a few years back. The pleasure was excruciating. The crash afterward more so. Clearly, the drug involves selling your soul. You slide your mouth off his long, stiff cock. Say, "No thanks." He takes another hit, the fumes drifting into your face. "There is no God, you know," he says. "You know." You bend over, going back to sucking his cock, but his dick is deflating now until it's just a soft thing with a foreskin lying on your tongue. "Maybe you should stop." "Keep your mouth on it." He sounds like he's not fooling. You keep sucking, not expecting a resurrection. Then you feel his hands slipping around your throat. He squeezes on your windpipe, and though you're alarmed, you nonetheless continue to suck. His grip tightens. You begin to see red, a prelude to death, perhaps, and you grab his forearms, bristling with coarse fur, but instead of pushing him away, you guide him to squeezing harder. After a while, the man lets loose a warm jet of piss in your mouth. Acrid, but not altogether unpleasant. You gulp it down to keep pace. "Don't spill a drop," he says. You want to tell him you won't, but your mouth is full. Piss still jetting from his foreskin, he fires up the glass pipe one more time. This is the Bardo of the Catholic martyrs, those whom suffering has made holy. The man with the knife bisecting his head, the woman carrying her carved-off tits on a plate, the holy sadomasochism of the Church of Rome. It is also, you think, swallowing furiously, a rather long way from that ad on Craigslist to here. Yes, it is. Go through this bardo of martyrdom, O nobly born, and head toward the light. "There is no God, you know," the speed freak has said. You're learning. Just a few days after the man with the truck and the meth pipe has dropped you off at your home, you continue on your path through Maya, the illusion that is the universe that is illusion. There is a private invitation-only monthly SM play party that you've been invited to, courtesy of a man you met in a bar who, while you were worshiping his feet, spit on you a lot. The party is in a private dungeon, the sort of place you've heard about but never seen. In one corner of the first room is a set of stocks, something from the Salem witch trials. In another corner stands a St. Andrew's cross. In the next room, a slim, almost skinny young man with a blissful expression on his lovely face is already tied to a bondage board, ropes encircling his body, while another man is hanging weights from the young man's stretched-out balls. A heavyset man walks by you, his torso pierced by a dozen hypodermic points, blood trickling down his hairy chest and belly. These are real human bodies going through extraordinary things. This is the place of possibilities fulfilled. This is the place that is making your cock so hard it hurts. Oh, nobly born, enter this bardo, remembering always that pain and pleasure are but two sides of the same illusion. A man approaches you, wearing gleaming leather chaps and vest, tattoos running down his thoroughly muscular arms, hands wearing gloves. He will be the agent of your suffering. He knows that, and so do you. There is ritual, yes, but beneath that, need, genuine need and fear, and something neither of you understands enough to give a name to it. Now you're shirtless, your wrists encircled by leather restraints. The man shoves you against a wall, shackles your wrist to a hook above your head. You have to stand on tiptoe, just barely keeping your balance. You wish you could suck off your tormentor or at least peer into his face, but you daren't look over your shoulder. Lot's wife reputedly did, and look what happened to her. The stranger comes up behind you and strokes your aching back with a gloved hand. He reaches around you, pulls you wobbly on tiptoe to his chest, warm chest, beating heart. If there were heaven, this would be it. But there is no heaven. The man backs away and a moment later slides a whip, a classic single-tail whip, into your line of sight. You've never even fantasized about being whipped, not with something like that. Empty your mind. Empty your mind. Let go of fear. Focus your mind on nothing at all. Breathe. The whip comes down. This is truly pain. Not erotic pain, just pain. Keep breathing. Keep breathing. The agony runs right through you, but it is not you. The whip descends again. You feel, or think you can feel, your skin splitting. Tears come to your eyes. Everything is red, the red of dried blood. There is no God, you know. Oh, nobly born, go fearlessly through the pain. No, you think. No, this has got to stop. Safe word. You know about safe words, but you neglected to arrange for one. There is no fucking God. You thought that was in your mind, but you said the words. Screamed them, actually. Everyone in the dungeon is looking your way. The whipping stops. The pain ends. The endorphins are flooding through you. You're high. So very high. The man comes close to you again. He undoes the shackles, and your aching arms drop to your sides. You almost collapse. He grabs you, clutches you to him, your back torn asunder against his warm, furry chest. He strokes your face. Until now, you haven't realized it's wet with tears. You're right, he whispers in your ear.
Thank you, O Nobly Born. Bisexual artist activist Juba Kalamka is most recognized for his work as co-founder and producer of the homo hop group Deep Dick Collective, DDC, and his development of the micro-label Sugar Truck Recordings. He received the 2005 Creating Change Award from the National Gay and Lesbian Task Force for his activist work in queer music community. He appears in numerous journals and anthologies, including Working Sex, Sex Workers Write About a Changing Industry, and the Yale Anthology of Rap. He lives in Oakland, California, with his primary partner of 11 years, their daughter, and an erotic standard poodle. He is very black and practices polyamory both locally and globally. Recognize game at jubakalamka.bandcamp.com. Juba Kalamka.
What up, y'all? How y'all doing, I see? That's good. I want to say thank you to Greta and to Dave for inviting me. I'm so glad to be here tonight. It's always good to be here at Center for Sex and Culture. And thanks again to, as always, to Carol and Robert. This is the first time I've gotten to read at a Godless Pervert event. I'm feeling very special to be here tonight, and it's a new direction for me to get to write about some of this stuff directly. So I wrote something special. It's a poem that I wrote, some of it will probably change a little bit later, but the one thing that will not change is that it's in the memory of a young brother named Aaron Muhammad, who was in the Nation of Islam with me. Yes, I was in the Nation of Islam from Chicago. I was in the Nation of Islam in the late 1980s, and Aaron killed himself in 1992. So this is in his memory, because he was a sweet, 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 wonderful young man who died of shame, essentially. So even though that there's a part of that, for me, of course, is sad, but Aaron's smile is all through this, too, as well. And it's called Jubilee Showcase. And here you go. They gasp, gagging, and clutching pearls, scooting uncomfortably back in their seats, knuckles bashing into hip bones, gasping, smucking, sucking teeth, aghast at the revelation. You what? They stare in disbelief. This devil, this hot boy. But they love this him. They love him. He is my good son. He is my good son who has made it here for us with his abacus flair, the flair of his pop collar and the flair of new jeans, new and crispy, and his beard freshly tapered and the wisp of sweet from the unscented Dr. Bronner soap. An unapproachable shoe game. Spit-shined black Stacy's are the choice today. He's sonorous. Resplendent in brown fits coordinated with his eyeglass frames as he frames this discussion. Reverend Deacon Dr. Sonoros, a father divine. These ideas and concepts, they be so relatable to the saints. These saints in his presence, as he presents to these presents, because they are gifts. These women are gifts in their positivity. These saints of midweek noontime Sunday dinner, minus smell good water, double mint gum, chowards, and wide, colorful hats. They are a part of my ground, so I stay open and I stay receptive, and I do breakdowns to the very last compounds. I hope to give agency at the agency. I sing for my supper. I am signifying fackin' and crackin' amongst this uncracking black. No, baby sister, it ain't my thing. It ain't that thing, mama. It just ain't. I'm just here to serve my people's mama. I'm just here to serve my people's mama. I grew up on the west side of Chicago, mama, with your mama them and baby sister them, and cuz. What your mama say about that, boy? Oh, well, you know how it go. You know them dashiki folk. The Garveyites and such, they love the Lord too, quiet as it's kept. So you know your mama and them, and you know I'm kind of like I live across the street from Church of God in Christ. So I'm from the west side, so I'm Baptist by default. Because I know all the songs. I know all the songs, all the Mahalias and all the Matty Moss and all the Milton Brunsons and all the Tommies and all the William Everett Preston. Will it go round in circles? Will it be unbroken? But I wrote a poem that ain't got no morals. But that ain't because I ain't got no center or a compass or a rudder. And they keep asking, how your mama feel about that? How you know wrong from right, boy? Well, I guess I just have a sense somehow, but I do wonder about folks and folks with books and particular sets of rules and admonitions and imperatives. Well, I just go for what I know. I go for what I know. I know that gay Babalao who helped me save my own life on video 25 years ago as his already gray locks swung at me through the TV tube, his tongue untied, following his Medusa snap, only sees his spiritual children when they need a reading or when they need the bones thrown, and they never come to bring his broke ass groceries or a ride to the train or just to visit him. Did you see him? Did the Orishas call you? Did you see him? Did you see his disappointment? The disappointment on his face reflected in your fresh run dishwater. Did the drum thunder ass clap talk to you from the distance? I can't hear you. I don't hear you, but I will shake the maracas at each of his altaros when I come through the door per the protocol, and I will have a cup of Bustelo and a cookie and remember to bring a Safeway card and fruit because they sustain him. Back when I was an undergrad, they hung out in the K building. That was the student union building. There was no dorms on campus yet on the south side. So we watched lots of Batman cartoons and played bidwists and ate microwave popcorn and cheeseburgers out of bags. And after class, there are always two long tables full of the saved, the born again, the blessed and highly favored, supping sodas and chips and stretching fried fish and American cheese sandwiches on wheat rolls, bubble water and wine candy, making a way through the just before payday on the edge of Pell disbursement, twin epidemics of Funzalo syndrome and Pakazemti's disease. These 12 boys fresh from the circle jerk in the basement of Cooley High. Disciples! 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 And this one girl. This unweeping Mary. This Martha not moaning. She'd be sitting here every day in this noontime repression ritual, this Seder of sublimation, because these choir boys with big black nuts, unfeasibly large testicles, would never, ever, ever think of those nasty, worldly, unclean thoughts about the sweat beating on her cleavage or the peach fuzz on her earlobe that the sun glinted through on that Friday before Easter, or that fist of a pussy straining through the crotch, calling to me through the crotch of those burgundy corduroy 501s when she sat down in the chair. No, not one of them did that. That was just me. That was me. That was me. And I'm sorry. Sorry. I mean, I'm really not sorry. I'm not sorry yet. I'm not sorry yet. But she told me that I would be sorry, and that I should watch out because he was coming back, and that he was angry and jealous and righteous, and that I would kneel before him. But she stopped, just sort of saying, "He's going to fuck your unbelieving face with his holy glowing halo ringed monster Jesus cock right here in the student union, and I'm going to frig my pussy through my pants and crush both the nipples and the bullet bra and watch. I'm not going to do that," she said, "because that would be decidedly unchristian." Shirley Caesar would surely seize her, but that wouldn't be quite right because, you know, Twinkie Clark is closer to her age, and Mother Mary and Barry, those runs that Twinkie does and those thighs, but I'm getting off track here. I'm getting off track. The devil is always at work now, ain't he? He's always at work. Now, where was I? Yes. Do you have a church home? No. Why not? Same reason I don't have a mosque home or a synagogue home or an ashram home. And he cracks up sitting across from me in my office. I think it's my stone face and fuck you, nigga, smile. That makes it clear our business is done, as he's clear that I could seriously complicate an impressionable ex-con's closer walk with thee. And we don't need no any more long-haired, free-thinking, dress-wearing, loose-booty, potential new boyfriends in the mix. So I'm left to my own devices for the moment, and these little spaces between and in larger ones of the clock, I will continue to collect toys for my ceremonial bureau top, lined with candles and evergreen pieces from behind my auntie's house and dirt from my mama's grave and pictures of leather daddies and fuck buddies and program supervisors gone too soon. And me and my girl will name our baby after Irish warbirds and blue African water mamas and trees and cotton-eyed granddaddy coal miners and still sing about going up the rough sides of mountains with my mama and about seven Spanish angels when she comes to town and not giving a fuck if it means shit or mean sixth sense to Chris Hitchens or any other arrogant white boys who can't wrap their mind around the idea of the spirit of the boogie or a love like a Holy Ghost swinging down on a sweet chariot to let me ride. Or having to believe that we are magic is about having nothing, not a one or a two or a three, stand in the way of our ineffability. I cannot love a Lord because I am too busy loving you. Thank you.
Juba Kalamka, thank you. David Fitzgerald is a writer, historical researcher, and atheist activist who is called both one of the busiest atheist activists in the Bay Area and the Ferris Bueller of San Francisco. David is on the Speakers Bureau of the Secular Student Alliance and is director, co-founder of the world's first atheist film festival and co-founder with Greta Christina and Chris Hall of the Godless Pervert Story Hour. He lectures around the country at universities and national secular events, but may be best known as the author of Nailed, 10 Christian Myths That Show Jesus Never Existed at All, and The Complete Heretic's Guide to Western Religion, Book 1, The Mormons. When not doing all that, he also writes paranormal erotica under the name Kilt Kiltpatrick with his girlfriend Dana Fredsti. Ladies, gentlemen, and people who are not neither ladies nor gentlemen, David Fitzgerald.
Hey there. So this goes out to two people who couldn't be here, two very special people, J and O. You know who you are. This is a repeat performance of a piece I did here before. It's a little nonfiction piece called There's Something About Paul. Part 1, A Thorn in the Flesh. The Apostle Paul was a lot of things. Some credit him as being the single most important figure to give us Christianity. And at the very least, he was the religion's first great missionary. But happy and carefree, he was not. Throughout his writings winds an underlying theme of deep pain. Something has Paul in a profound state of despair. But what? Paul himself seems to say the problem is physical. There was given to me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from exalting myself. Three times I appealed to the Lord about this, but it would not leave me, he says in 2 Corinthians. What is this torment of Paul's? Well, countless varieties of ailments have been suggested over the centuries, including epilepsy, malaria, chronic earaches, migraines, stammering or some other speech disability, or just all the beatings he received from adversaries, rivals, and persecutions. But none of these guesses seems capable of causing the depths of negativity that Paul frequently descends to. However, he does offer some hints as to what this problem could be. In Galatians 5:22-24, the last on his list of fruits of the Spirit is self-control. And then he adds that those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Listen to what else Paul says about his affliction. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold into slavery under sin. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do not do what I want to do, I agree that the law is good, but in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will to do what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it's no longer that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my innermost self, but I see in my members another law at war with myself, with my mind making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Wow. Paul is not talking about an earache. Let's consider this anguished, quivering, barely coherent soliloquy again. His torment is no medical condition, nor is it any external adversary or hardship. It's nothing less than an evil, that he cannot even understand, which lives within him. It makes him do that which he hates, against his will. He knows what he should do, but the sin living in his members wars with him, making him captive. His self-loathing reaches a crescendo in the very next verse as he confesses, "So then, with my mind I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh I am a slave to the law of sin." What else does Paul feel strongly about? Well, if there's one thing Paul hates, it's homosexuals. Those sinful wretches whom God has abandoned to uncleanliness and vile passions. He repeatedly blasts the effeminate and the sodomites, those who abuse themselves with mankind. Yes, homosexuals, those without natural affection, who practice such things are deserving of death. And not only them, but even those who approve of them as well. Ooh, he really hates those men who do such evil things. And as many have noted, he's not all that crazy about women either. It's good for a man not to touch a woman, he tells us in 1 Corinthians. Though he does repeatedly instruct the men to always greet each other with a holy kiss. He is also deeply ambivalent towards marriage. He advises the unmarried man not to seek a wife. After all, he should care about how he may please the Lord, not worry about trivial things like how he may please his wife. And he begrudgingly allows that some men, unlike Paul, can't seem to control their urges towards women. So if they can't remain unencumbered by a woman and practice self-control, like Paul, then he supposes they should marry, for it's better to marry than to burn with passion. But make no mistake about it, this is just a concession on his part. As he outright tells us, he has no use for the distractions of women. What he really wishes is that all men could be like he is. 1 Corinthians 7:7. So if there's something about that seems awfully gay, you're not the first to think so either. But for centuries, no one dared mention Paul's obsession with homosexuality. Episcopal Bishop John Shelby Spong drew a tremendous amount of ire from his fellow outraged Christians when he first dared to consider the possibility that Paul was gay. But when you reread Paul's letters with this hypothesis in mind, it certainly seems to unlock some of his more mysterious statements. In 1 Corinthians 9, he tells us that in order to save sinners, to the weak I became as weak. It's puzzling to know just what he means by this. However, if by the weak he means weak like those effeminate men that he mentioned a few paragraphs earlier, then this starts to make sense as a defensive rationalization and explanation for any unseemly weak behavior he may have shown. It also makes sense in light of his guilt-driven need to punish himself for his evil desires. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Of course, the new reading also opens some tantalizing new questions. For instance, in 2 Corinthians 2:4, Paul mentions an earlier letter of tears. Out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote unto you with many tears. His first letter to the Corinthians doesn't seem to match this description, so this letter of tears has been lost to us, like so many other letters of Paul, and perhaps it was deliberately suppressed, along with so many other early Christian writings later deemed troublesome. So what was in it? We may never know, but it must have been a doozy. Bring me back my slave boy. Paul's New Testament letter to Philemon certainly takes on a whole new meaning when you read it with this new viewpoint. At first glance, it simply appears that Paul is writing to Philemon, a Christian slave owner, to forgive his runaway slave, Onesimus, who is now also a Christian. The letter has long been discussed by theologians and writers on Christian social ethics because of Paul's casual acceptance of slavery. But the most startling part of the letter seems to have been completely overlooked. Paul isn't just asking Philemon to forgive his fugitive slave boy. He's asking Philemon to send his wayward slave boy back to Paul. And he isn't just asking. Watch Don Paul the Godfather in action. After spending the first 7 verses effusively sweet-talking Philemon, he then turns on the screws on him with an impressive barrage of thinly disguised demands, a healthy dollop of guilt, a smattering of big boo-boo kitty-eyed pleading, and finally, the ironclad expectation of complete obedience. He says, "For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I'm appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he's indeed useful, both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him here with me, so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel, but I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary, and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you may have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more so to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about you owing me even your very self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. Paul is quite motivated in this letter. He really, really, really wants young Onesimus back. Count how many times he cajoles poor Philemon to do his duty for this poor old man in prison and fork over the young slave. Paul calls the youth his son, his own heart, a beloved brother, both in the Lord and in the flesh. When Paul raves about how useful Onesimus is, he's making a pun. Onesimus means useful or handy in Greek. But he really means it. Onesimus is of service to Paul. In the King James translation, Paul says, he ministers to me in my chains. Given the dubious desire, obvious desire of Onesimus' service and the battery of blatant strong-arm tactics that Paul puts on Philemon, it's difficult to interpret it any other way but as evidence for homosexual leanings. Longtime companions. We also can't help but take a second look at Paul's significant others, if you will. Both the book of Acts and Paul tell us that he and his partner Barnabas, another missionary bachelor, had a bitter falling out. But it's interesting that they give conflicting reasons for why. Paul says it was over the issue of eating with Gentiles, but the book of Acts says it was over their younger companion, John Mark. But was there some other reason altogether behind their breakup? If we don't mind taking a trip into the realm of supermarket tabloid speculation, we can come up with some juicy possibilities. Did Paul come on to Barnabas? Was there a lover spat? Did Barnabas sail away with John Mark for reasons other than missionary work? Ask your pastor what he thinks. Of course, we can't leave any discussion of Paul's foray into the love that dare not speak its name without a word about Timothy, the Robin to his Batman. If we can trust the book of Acts, though really maybe we can't, Paul wanted Timothy from the moment he saw him, that is, to come out with him and be a missionary. Paul even went out of his way to personally circumcise Timothy, even though he had violently, there was no need for him to, because he'd already violently opposed the Jerusalem church leaders over the very issue and put his foot down against it. But for some reason, he still felt it necessary to take the matter in hand and personally attend to Timothy's worrisome foreskin anyway. But unnecessary penile surgery or no, Timothy remained unmarried and close to Paul for life. He's often referred to in Paul's writings both as his beloved and faithful son, or brother and fellow laborer. Not that there's anything wrong with that. How ironic and sad if the verses of the Bible most often used to justify millennia of homophobia and misogyny came from the pen of a self-loathing homosexual like Paul or any number of other right-wing Republican senators. It's fascinating to speculate what else might have happened to Christianity if Paul had come out of the closet. Without his pent-up neuroses driving the early church's greatest missionary, would Christianity have even survived? Or would it have been transformed right from the beginning into a gentler, more tolerant faith? Maybe, but it sure didn't, so fuck 'em.
David Fitzgerald, among my very favorite biblical historians. Dana Fredsti is an ex-B-movie actress with a background in theatrical sword fighting, a skill she utilized in the movie Army of Darkness as a deadite and fight captain. She's addicted to bad movies and any book or film, good or bad, which includes zombies. She is the author of the Ashley Parker series, Plague Town, Plague Nation, and the upcoming Plague World, Titan Books, touted as Buffy meets The Walking Dead, as well as the cozy noir mystery Murder for Hire, The Peruvian Pigeon, and several spicy genre romances written under the name Inara LaVey. She's also co-written two nonfiction sex self-help books, What Women Really Want in Bed and Secret Seductions, with Cynthia Gentry. She lives in San Francisco with her boyfriend, David Fitzgerald, who writes erotica under the name pen name Kilt Kilpatrick, and also contributed to both nonfiction books. Their dog, Pogeen, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, and a small horde of felines. It's not so small, I've been there. ladies and gentlemen, Dana Fredsti.
This is also going out to JNO, and yes, you know who you are. Unlike a lot of my friends and family, my sister and I were raised pretty much without any kind of religion. We didn't go to church, we didn't say prayers, we didn't say grace, but somehow, because our society is so inculcated in Christianity and its history, like the true meaning of Christmas and Adam and Eve and all of that, As I grew up, I assumed that all of this was real. I assumed that, you know, baby Jesus was the son of God, that Adam and Eve were, you know, in the Garden of Eden. I also thought that people coexisted with dinosaurs and rode them. I blame Christmas specials and the Flintstones for some of this. Basically, I did not spend a lot of critical thought on this until I got a lot older, and luckily I chose evolution instead of creationism when it did come down to it. So my mom is a very liberal person, and I found out recently a closet atheist. But she also was raised in the 50s, and along with that came that conservative attitude towards sex. So like religion, it was something that we just did not really talk about in our house. So along with Jesus riding dinosaurs, another thing my subconscious picked up on was that sex, if not bad, was something I just was not supposed to enjoy. So when I, oh gosh, between the ages of 13 and 18, I read a lot of bodice rippers. So, you know, talk about a very warped message. I mean, it's like, hey, ladies, rape is great if the guy is a hunk. And you can totally enjoy it because that's not your idea. And wow, did you know virgins can have multiple orgasms with just vaginal sex the very first time? It's true. So my first time sucked. I did not enjoy it, and I became a retroactive virgin for 3 years. I was waiting for that mythical hunky, not quite a rapist, with that oh-so-talented manly rod who would give me multiple orgasms that weren't my fault. So it took me a lot of years to really understand that sex was something that I could enjoy without guilt, and that it could even be my idea, and it was still not wrong. And the real turning point for me was when I got involved with a couple that were very close friends, and I ended up having what I call a friendlationship with them. And they treated sex as an extension of the friendship, and it was so natural and guilt-free and fun that it basically just kicked the shit out of any remaining hang-ups that I had about sex. And, oh, thank you so much, and you know who you are. So when Dave and I first got together, we did a kind of cultural slash gift exchange by writing each other erotic short stories. And we both got to list three elements that we wanted each other to include in the story. So, and if you know Dave, you're not going to be surprised at his list. He gave me a foreign location, foreign language, two women, and the element of surprise. In other words, one of the characters is not expecting what happens. So the story I wrote for him ended up being published by a company called Ravenous Romance, and you want to roll Ravenous Romance, you have to roll the R's with that. And it started my career as a part-time erotic romance writer. So the story got expanded into a novel, and it's also dedicated to that couple that I mentioned. And it really helped me come to terms with my own sexuality and open my eyes and my mind to the possibility that all of these rules and restrictions that had seeped into my subconscious thanks to society and the 50s and all that is probably just bullshit. So the excerpt I'm reading is from Champagne, and while the book itself is porny porn 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 porn, because I am my mother's daughter, the excerpt I'm reading is just porn. So the setup for this is Jeanette, my heroine, and her boyfriend Daryl are the guests of the Rue de Bois, who have a champagne house in Champagne, France, because that's where the champagne houses go. So Jeanette has been invited by Marie-Elise to go downstairs to try some very, very special champagne. Maria Elise led me through a door at the end of the dining room, down a small hallway and through yet another door, a thick wooden one with iron hinges. It opened onto the top of gently curving stone stairs. The light at the top of the landing was dim, with nothing but blackness below, and I clutched the iron railing, wondering how I'd navigate the stairs without spilling my champagne. Maria Elise, a few steps ahead of me, turned and gave me a mischievous grin that replaced the sophisticated woman with the 15-year-old schoolgirl. "Drink some now and lose less to the floor." She took a hefty swig of her champagne. I laughed and followed suit. "You read my mind." Maria Elise smiled again. "Ah, but can you read mine?" With that, she descended the stairs into darkness. The further down we went, the more the temperature dropped and the dim light faded into inky shadows. I felt like a gothic heroine going to explore the forbidden cellar against my better judgment. I followed close behind her, catching the wafting scent of vanilla from her perfume. I liked it. It smelled like something I'd want to have for dessert. It was pitch black at the bottom of those stairs, and I bumped into Maria Elise when she abruptly stopped. Champagne sloshed over my flute and spilled onto my fingers. "I'm so sorry." "No, I should have warned you that I'm stopping." There was a small click, and light illuminated the first 20 feet of the room, which was better described as a subterranean cavern. The roof arched high above us, wooden supports following the curve of the ceiling. Racks upon racks of emerald-green champagne bottles stretched back into the shadows. "Oh, wow." "Yes." Maria Elise nodded complacently. The Rue du Bois legacy spread out before us. It goes back a quarter of a mile under the hills. I licked the spilled champagne from my fingers as I stared at the sea of bottles. It's like Aladdin's cave. There is certainly treasure to be found here. Something in her tone pulled my attention back to my hostess, who was watching me with an unreadable expression as I licked my fingers. I hastily stopped what I was doing, wondering if I'd inadvertently committed some unforgivable breach of French etiquette. But no, she didn't look angry. If anything, she looked almost hungry. The truly wonderful thing about champagne. Maria Elise took my hand in hers, is that it goes with almost everything. She lifted my hand to her mouth and kissed it, her gaze never leaving mine. The air suddenly seemed thicker, and I felt warm despite the cool temperature of the cellars. Do you know how champagne is made? She let go of my hand with an abruptness that was as disconcerting as that brief kiss had been, and walked over to the nearest rack. Well, Daryl tried to explain it, but you didn't really listen because he's boring. That startled a laugh out of me. Enthusiasts are often tedious, she continued. When one develops an enthusiasm, one can either inspire others to share this passion or push them away by being tedious. Listening to Daryl, I think he's one of the second type. I surprised myself by asking, if he's so boring, why did you invite him to visit you? The champagne was having more of an effect than I'd thought. She gave me an amused smile. What makes you assume it was Daryl we wanted as our guest? Well, Maria Elise laughed at my expression. Now, it is not so boring if one already has the same interest as both I and Allery do. But it's easy to see that Daryl has not yet discovered there is more pleasure in building the desire in another to learn than there is in thinking oneself superior. She hit that one right in the nose, I thought. Now, Allery and myself, we are much more interested in sharing our passions through experience rather than lecturing. For example, she went over to a refrigerator behind a rough wooden bar and pulled out a half bottle of champagne. This is our demi-sec, a sweeter style than the other two. I am very pleased with it. Try a taste. I looked dubiously at my half-full flute. I still have some of the other left. C'est facile. She drained her glass and poured some of the demi-sec. We will share. She took a sip and held the flute out to me. Still holding the other glass, I took it and tried a small taste. Flavors of honey and apricot sparkled in the bubbles. It was delicious. I took another sip, more this time, and handed the flute back to Maria Elise. She wrapped her fingers around both my fingers and the flute, holding my hand around the glass as she lifted it to her lips. Her touch sent an unexpected fusion of warmth through my body, something about the firm grasp of her hand around mine. There was strength in those well-manicured fingers that made me wonder if I could pull away. Maybe it was the champagne, but I liked the idea that perhaps I couldn't. My face flushed with heat at the thought. She gently stroked the back of my hand as she drank, a light butterfly touch that raised goosebumps all over my body. Here. She lifted the glass to my lips and tilted it so a stream of champagne poured into my mouth. I swallowed and she withdrew the glass, but not quickly enough. A few drops of champagne trickled from my lips down my chin, dripping onto the exposed flesh of my breasts.
One thing we cannot allow with Rue de Bois Champagne, Marie-Elise murmured in a tone as rich and decadent as chocolate mousse, is waste. Still holding my hand, she dipped her head to my chest and slowly licked the trail of champagne from my skin, moving from cleavage up to my neck, her hair falling in a veil across her face as she did so. My breathing quickened, and my nipples stiffened in response as she gently nipped the base of my neck. I tried to draw back, afraid of the sensation that coursed through me at the touch of Marie-Elise's tongue on my flesh, but I found myself backed up against the wooden bar with no place to retreat. I felt her lips curve in a smile against my skin before her mouth resumed its leisurely pace up to my mouth. Je veux t'embrasser. Her voice caressed me as she traced the outline of my lips with the tip of her tongue. She kissed me then, a firm yet gentle kiss that tasted as sweet and intoxicating as the champagne. I felt her remove the butterfly clip in my hair and entwine her fingers, pulling my head back with a slight tug that made me gasp. Even as she increased the pressure of the kiss, her tongue like warm velvet against mine, warmth coiled lazily in my stomach and spread throughout all erogenous zones. My free hand involuntarily loosed its grasp on the other champagne flute, which slipped from my fingers before I realized what had happened. It hit the ground and shattered. Marie-Elise withdrew her mouth from mine and made a tsk-tsk sound. What did I say about waste? I started to apologize, but she quickly kissed me again, nipping gently at my bottom lip as she gave my hair another sharp tug. Shh, don't worry. I will think of a way for you to pay for that. Another kiss. She knew exactly how to use her teeth and tongue to elicit a response. Not too hard, not too soft. Just right. De Chablis Trois, she whispered, her lips moving to my ear and sending another jolt of electricity through my body. She nipped my earlobe and repeated sharply this time, De Chablis Trois. I looked at her in confusion. She gave a small laugh. I forgot you don't speak French. Another thing to teach you. She kissed me one more time, then stepped back, releasing my hand and my hair. Take off your clothes, Jeanette.
That was my girlfriend wrote that. Before we have our last speaker, I just want to remind you, after her, we'll be having a panel of Q&A with all our authors, so stick around for that. But before that, Kate Searles is a political activist who's been writing for the freethinking community since 2009. A writer and educator who enjoys moving people through the written word, she's taken advantage of her religious past as a Wiccan, fundamentalist Christian, and Mormon to stir the minds of the religious and non-religious alike. Her life is a concoction of literature, writing, wine, and debate with carefree doses of roller coasting and theater arts. She lives in Las Vegas, Nevada, where she teaches fifth grade. Please welcome Kate Searles.
Good evening. So when I first wrote this piece, I've been inspired to write about the various sexual encounters I've had that were intertwined with religion. Either I'd been religious, as David pointed out, or my partner was, or leftover religious inhibitions lingered over our heads. My fascination with religious sex, which was often closely related to shameful sex or penis-centric sex, left me a desire to write about said experiences. And the first drafts of this piece were thusly titled, Dear Religious Men I've Had Sex With. The subsequent drafts revealed to me, however, that I wished my writing to be less penis-centric than these encounters themselves had been, and I call this version simply One of Those Girls. 1,629,360,000 heartbeats ago, estimated roughly, I made my first appearance in this world. And approximately 8 to 10 years later, or 525,600,000 heartbeats ago, or so, I made a promise to my dad. I didn't hesitate in this promise, as it seems so easy and so natural a promise to make. My father didn't shake with reproachful passion at his request that my virginity remain intact until I rested safely behind the monogamous walls of marriage, nor did he hover with any semblance of intimidation. His expression, rather, remained solemnly serious as he said simply, promise me you'll wait to have sex until you're married. I, brimming with good intentions, solemnly agreed. And then, 394,200,000 heartbeats later, as I prepared to have my first penetrative sex with a man who was definitely not my husband, my mind inadvertently drifted to the obvious disappointment my father would be feeling had he been there to watch my cherry proverbially pop. For me personally, this looming vision of my father had a fairly negative effect on the mood, which created a rather understandable dissonance of the cognitive persuasion. Naked boyfriend, looming father. Naked boyfriend, looming father. My rather religious boyfriend finally asked me what was wrong, and I decided to be honest about the promise I was about to break, because it seemed, somehow, at least a bit more sexy than the admission that I was nervous about the likelihood of pain in the coming moments, and embarrassed that I had no real idea how to use my tongue on his dick. So, blushing not unlike a bride on her wedding night, I replied, I promised I wouldn't do this till I was married. Penetration halfway complete, only half of my supposed virginity still intact, my boyfriend elicited an unrecognizable expression halfway between confusion and a veil and said, Kate, I understand why you do that, but we love each other, right? We'll be married one day. His words and subsequent smile revealed that he assumed his intention to marry me would appease Jesus in the here and now. But it was a promise, I responded quietly. And then the obvious fullness of half a penis inside my now only halfway virginal vagina was beginning to diminish. So, fearing that my boyfriend's interest was shrinking as quickly as his erection, I made the awkward decision to shift the burden of the virginity promise from my human father to an idea I knew my boyfriend had a better understanding for in all things. Jesus! I made my promise, I lied, to God. Sure as shit, a look of understanding dawned on his face. Oh. As if, you know, the ghost of my father, or any other human being for that matter, created an uncomfortable and inappropriate presence in the midst of our almost sex. But the image of all-seeing God and his contracts with us mortals was an understandable and even expected presence in the room. I'm quite sure that neither of us knew quite whether half a penis buried in half a vagina constituted a reactionary response from God for having gone that far, or whether God would be proud that we both laid in bed without orgasm, halfway between sex and non-sex, quietly waiting for some sort of celestial blessing to believe that the experience was what we thought to be sex. And we waited in uncomfortable silence for something. An interruption in the electricity, a booming God-like voice, or perhaps a random free broadcasting of illicit porn in our hotel room television set. But nothing came, really. After minutes, we were still just two people, unsure and yet sure, about whether we wanted to have sex, but our God seemed to be rather silent on the topic. And I wondered, honestly, how God felt about the guilty pleasure I took in having a semi-flaccid penis halfway inserted into me. In the end, we finished having sex. I'm sure God enjoyed it, as, you know, we all do when we head to the awkward first-time virgin sex section of the porn aisle. I'm kidding, of course. I never expect anyone to be interested, really, in my first male-on-female, non-coital sexual encounter. But none fail to impress me like the religious. And it happened to be a religious man who wanted to know approximately 832,200,000 heartbeats or so after my first heterosexual intercourse when I had lost my virginity. Now, at this point, said virginity had been lost for years, but the fantasy that non-virginity equated to a bad, bad girl was apparently alive and well with this one. We'd had some freaky sex. My legs in the air, my body against the wall, his cock never losing its rhythmic pulsing both inside and outside my body. But he became angry, see, when I resisted his attempt to push my head down onto said pulsating cock. And I told him it wasn't because I had an aversion to giving head that I actually gave great head, but because he'd already made it clear that licking my clit was off the table. Which is fine, but don't expect me to suck your dick, I told him. My actual resistance to deep-throating his dick led him to asking, with some level of disdain, when I'd lost my virginity and become one of those girls. One of those girls, he explained, who lived in, and I quote, sexual sin. Not the marrying type, he clarified, but a girl who would have sex with anyone and served to help boys become men before they settle down with proper godly women. Girls who lived out these men's darkest fantasies. Girls who didn't object to being referred to as girls any more than they objected to the notion that a man's sexual freedom is natural and expected, but said freedom for a woman makes her one of those girls, overlooked and haunted by fathers whose strangleholds on their daughters' virginities suffocated for the sole purpose that they would not become one of those girls. One of those girls who, you know, experiences a sex drive and carries with her the extreme expectation that her own pleasure should be taken seriously. One of those girls that likes sex and likes orgasms and likes explorations in bed that involve more than being jackhammered into oblivion. One of those girls with a bucket of cold water assertion that her own sexual pleasure is not necessarily tied to what's pleasing her partner, and a definitive lack of interest in what might rock her proverbial socks is a distinct turnoff. I told this religious man whom I'd welcomed into my bed and into my body that I'd not been a girl who'd lost her virginity, but a woman who'd gained recognition of her sexuality, a woman who'd taken half a step forward in understanding this primal, yet magnificent and mysterious part of my humanity. Why, I asked, did he so easily refer to my virginity as something I'd lost, as though it were so precious a thing I would forever mourn its passing from my life rather than celebrate the experience and sense of self I happened to be gaining from its loss? My tone brimming with passionate resentment, I recounted everything I'd learned, taken, and given since I'd lost what he considered so valuable. The understanding of what makes me hot and what doesn't. Of the positions that turn me on or the kinks that make me wet. Or, for example, out of the kind of anal sex that will make me orgasm. Or the discovery of how I melt beneath another human tongue flicking its way over my clit until my back arches and my body shakes because I can barely take any more. Of the ways in which role-playing can add spice and surprise to every encounter, and the realization that people are at times sexually compatible and sometimes they're not, and a marriage license is not going to ever make the former magically happen. Well, actually, that's not the way it happened. I felt these words, and I thought some version of them, but I did not vocalize them because some parts of me, minute and segregated into smaller parts of my mind, did not entirely disagree with him. My father's request that I promise him my virginity until we could both hand it over to one man and one man alone echoed through my entire body, and tiny weeds of shame poked up unexpectedly. Perhaps they'd been there festering all along. And although I'd like to recount this sexual experience as one in which I left a non-penetrable, non-believing woman confident in her own slutty female skin, the reality is that I immediately made up an excuse about simply having to be somewhere else. And I left. I didn't comment on my girlhood or my womanhood, my virginity, or when I supposedly lost it. I just left. I escaped. The shame of commonly interpreted biblical sexuality lingers like a dark storm cloud, even at times beyond the point when girls like us think it can no longer touch us. That's no secret. But the day that I discovered myself enveloped in the arms of non-belief, 500 million or so beats of my heart ago. That cloud transformed into a gentle reminder of not what I've lost through human nonconformity, but everything I've gained. It is a reminder that my time here on this planet will be over in a billion heartbeats, a million, perhaps 1,000. I don't know. Maybe it matters. But likely, it doesn't matter at all how many beats my heart has experienced or how many beats more I will feel, but rather how deeply I feel the encounters I do and do not allow myself to experience. My interactions with other human beings will likely defy my existence once every part of myself disappears with the ceasing of my heart. There is only now, no eternal life through which to get it right, to explore myself, to reap some fucking reward for withholding my sexual self instead of allowing every relationship to be meaningful and beautiful and hurtful and rewarding and everything in between. The realization, see, that all relationships eventually come to an end makes them all meaningful in one way or another. Dear religious men I've had sex with, yes, I am saying that my long-term relationships and my short-term relationships and my one-night stand are as meaningful as your marriages because I demand them to be. Because as an atheist, you see, they must be, which is now why non-belief has made me grow into someone with no interest in withholding myself or pretending that I am some non-sexual being in order to please a god. As a finite biological being, sex plays a role in many parts of who I am. Sex is one of many ways I experience physical pleasure and also how I bond with those whom I have promised myself to for the moment, the year, the day, whatever. It is fun and sacred and meaningful and always full of significance and implication, regardless of the fact that I am proudly one of those girls. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Kate, and thanks to all of the performers. We're going to take an extremely short break, about 2 minutes. We're going to set up the stage for Q&A, and we're going to move the camera. Our apologies to the internet audience. Moving the camera may make you sick to your stomach. We're going to do it as quickly as we can. Hang in there. We will be back in about 2 minutes for Q&A with the performers, and we will be taking questions from the live audience and also from the internet audience through the chat.
Do keep in mind we only have the one microphone, so we will be passing it between ourselves. If you have a question, raise your hand loudly so that we can see you because these lights are very bright. Ask us the question. We'll repeat the question on the microphone for the viewers across the world. Thanks so much. We'll be right back.
Sure.
Yeah. So I don't hope it matters.
Okay. Can we get all our tonight's authors up on stage and we'll get this party started?
Sure.
Like I could deny you anything. Where's our Dana?
Juba? Juba? There's our Juba. That was rapid. Let us know when the cameras are set up and we can take this on again. And while we're in this little awkward pause, A big shout of thanks to the Center for Sex and Culture again, Carol Queen, Robert, all the volunteers from Godless Perverts who came at the last minute and helped out with the filming, with the transportation, logistics, and the food. Hmm? And Dave and Margaret.
Thanks to Victor for the cheesecake. Yeah. Rochelle's Cheesecakes.
Hey, I know how to show.
Yes. So, Chris and Dave, whenever you're ready for us to get going again, we'll start going. All right, rock on. So, we are back with the Q&A panel. Again, I'm David Fitzgerald from left to right. Just want to introduce everybody once more again. Kate Searles, Dana Fredsti, Simon Sheppard, Virgie Tovar, Juba Kalamka, yes, and Greta Christina. If you have any questions here in the audience, just go ahead and raise your hands. We can see you now. Chris will be taking in calls from the internet too, so world, come out and talk to us soon. In the meantime, I'll start with a quick question is, how did you guys get started with erotica? And whoever wants to grab first answer at that, go for it. You did. Okay.
Yeah, I already said.
Anybody who hasn't answered that question already, or who has a better question. Oh, Simon, go on.
Let's see. Quite a while ago, a man named Bill Brent, the late Bill Brent, who actually started Perverts, put out, among other things, read my erotic poetry and said, why don't you write a daddy boy story? And I did. And I sold it to the late Scott O'Hara, a porn star with a really big cock, who was amazingly at bottom. And I made more money selling that story, that first story, than just about anything I've sold in the succeeding 20 years.
Wow.
So,
an atheist miracle.
It was. And the rest is non-history.
Anybody else?
No. I'll take a very quick answer. I wrote erotic nonfiction and you know, nonfiction about sex for many years before I even tried to write porn. I always sort of thought, oh, I'm one of those down-to-earth writers who always has to write about reality. And then somewhere it occurred to me, oh, porn is a sex fantasy written down and shaped into a form that other people might want to read. And it was like, oh, that's all it is. I'm already making up fantasies all the time, every time I jerk off. You know, every time I jerk off, I'm writing fiction in my head. I might as well just do that on paper and in pixels.
Oh, yeah, I just want to say real quick, too, is that I don't know if I've ever really considered myself as an erotica writer as such, but part of the way I started writing about sex, and this is either in a hip-hop context or in a poetic context, was about actually being discouraged to because of my political and cultural community backdrop as an artist, and that writing and talking about so that was always something that was a germ in my head about in the same way about, like, this is what I'm jerking off to, this is what I'm thinking about, this is what I'm watching, but that art and creating and being creative was about doing urban renewal murals and, you know, that kind of thing like that, that there's never anything sexy. I mean, depends. Well, it depends on how you look at them. I mean, I think that's what it's about, too, is about the gaze. So it was like that was something that became intriguing for me, figuring out where to sort of pull that out, so to speak.
Funny story, when she was talking about the two of us writing stories to each other, the story that I wrote for her, she took and gave it to her publishers without telling me and said, well, what do you think of this guy's writing? And I've been an erotic writer ever since. And the funny thing about that is this was at a time when my agent was shopping the manuscript for Nailed around New York, and I was terrified that people would find out that Dave Fitzgerald, biblical scholar, was also Kilt Kilpatrick erotica writer, because that would just destroy everything. And then it was one day I had an epiphany. It's like, you know, if you're an atheist biblical scholar, you've already blown all your credibility with the Christians, and the atheists don't care. They love it. They love it. So now I did a complete 180, and I pimp out Kilt Kilpatrick / Dave Fitzgerald at every opportunity I can.
Yeah. Okay, so I got my start in erotica when my sister, who's also an erotica writer, told me, Lisa Lane, she's an amazing writer, shout out to her, She was mentioning a book of short stories that was being released around the Christmas time called it was either the 12 Fucks of Christmas or the 12 Sexy Days of Christmas, something like that. And the 12 Sexy Days of Christmas. Thank you, Dana. It would be better as 12 Fucks, though, don't you think? Yeah, that's the synopsis. I'd read the 12 Fucks of Christmas. Anyhow, she was mentioning that they were looking for writers, so I submitted a proposal and got myself a short story for the Six Geese Allay, which was very interesting to write for, but I got hooked. I was like, this is amazing, writing about sex. And so I've never really gone back. And being able to link that with my atheism has been a very good outlet for me, so to speak. So that's how I got my start. Here we are.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, young man there with the glasses.
Ooh, lots.
His question is, how much research do we have to do for our sex? I'm going to hand that to Simon.
I will say that everything you heard, I have done.
Wow.
Pretty much. I couldn't take the single tail whip past two strokes. My bad.
No judgment. No judgment here.
So it depends on what you mean by research. and also depends on whether you're talking about fiction or nonfiction, because obviously we have fiction, nonfiction, poetry. We've had spoken word here, and I think that's so it's different for everybody. And I've read both fiction and nonfiction. You know, for the piece I read today, I sort of had to look up what was the age of the universe again. Was it 13.7 billion years? But otherwise, it's just my opinion. And for erotica, I tend actually not so much to write erotica about things I've done so much as, you know, sometimes I do, but it's mostly I write erotica about things I think about. You know, it's like, what am I thinking about when I'm jerking off, and how can I turn that into a story that somebody else wants to read? But, you know, I also write a fair amount of nonfiction and bring it here to Godless Perverts, and, you know, there have been times when it's like really just spewing whatever's in my head, and there's times when I'm like, you know, on the internet for hours, you know, trying to look up, what was it exactly that the Catholic Church said about abortion, or you know, something like that. So it really varies. Anybody else?
Yes, I did. Yeah. I can basically say would say too is that a lot of particularly with what I wrote today, that all of those are experiences, like the specific stuff that that happened, and it actually the piece is actually named after Jubilee Showcase, which was a gospel television, an amazing television show that ran in Chicago for about 25 years, I think 1960 to about 1984 or so. And a big thing about the things that I write, wherever it is I'm writing, is about intersectionality and about figuring out a way to, like, I don't like leaving pieces of myself at the door. I'm a porn actor as well, and that really is, I mean, at that particular space of expression really had gave me another. Actually, they sort of cross informs my writing, conversation I have with other porn performers. I do sex work advocacy, so there's little pieces of everything, real, like a lot of real life. I mean, names get changed to protect the ignorant, so to speak. but lots of the stuff that I say that are things that really actually happen, and are real people who are involved. And there's some historical research, but lots of stuff about cultural and personal history is actually really stuff that happened.
I just want to amend that. in this case, everything that I wrote, that you heard, I had done. But, you know, I try not to do confessional stuff. I try and take that raw material and make it into some kind of shapely piece of fiction, because I've published over 300 stories, and I really would have to be a really busy boy.
For sure. How's that sound? Oh, we still have it.
Do you have one?
I've
got a quick one. Yeah. You know, I do fiction and nonfiction, but we're here talking about the fiction mostly, the erotica. I do a lot of research, but not for the sex stuff. That usually just writes itself. It's always about, you know, I'm a big language freak and I'm a history major, so I really get deep into the settings and what people were thinking at the time of it. And usually there's like this big iceberg of stuff that never even makes it into the story for every story I've got, but that informs it.
For the nonfiction, like for what women really want in bed, let me just say SurveyMonkey. We interviewed a lot of women about what they liked in bed and disseminated the information from that into the book. For fiction, I used to never, ever, ever research. It was like, I don't need no stinking research. And then I started writing some of that, like Fixation, one of the books over there. There's a lot to do with exotic feline breeding. I actually worked at a breeding facility, and so I did a lot of the research on the job at the time. For champagne, I drank a lot of champagne because I thought it was important. And for everything else, like for some of the fight stuff I write, I asked Dave, hey, honey, can you stand here and let me see if this works? And I tried that with some of the sex stuff, too. So, yes, it works nicely.
You know what? Basically, for the things I write, fiction, creative, nonfiction, a lot of it comes from my past, and a lot of it is basically self-explanatory. Everyone's covered it. So, let's turn it over to the audience. Yes, so he's asking, how do you take a three-word sex act and make it fresh?
Which three words?
Which three words? Okay, so any act that can be described in three words. Any sex act, how do you make it fresh? In my opinion, as a writer, this is all about words. I am a word whore, and I love words. To me, words are like, it's like a puzzle. They're all scattered all over the place, but if you put them together in just the right way, it creates such a beautiful picture that everybody can appreciate. And I think that sex is something that's very primal. It's something that all humans experience. It's something we all relate to. And yet, you can use words to create a unique, a really enticing experience all over again. And that's how we continue to be turned on by the same sex acts again and again and again. It's artists using words or using their bodies on film. It's how we use our art in order to pull you in, really.
Yeah, for me, when I'm writing the sex scenes, I think about what for me is a turn on. I don't write something unless I personally find it extremely erotic. And what she said about being a was it language whore, word whore?
A word whore.
Yeah, no, exactly. It's just like sex starts, at least for me, in the brain. And I can watch porn until the cows come home and make little cows, and it makes no difference. You can say exactly the right sentence in exactly the right tone, and my brain sparks, and it's like, okay, I'm yours, baby. So.
Yeah, I agree that if you're not turned on while writing the sex scene, they're not going to be turned on when they read it. I think the most difficult thing is coming up with new words for body parts. And all the words for the body parts are pretty much horrible down the line. So you really have to get creative with that, I find. Yeah, it gets – without getting into purple prose.
Yeah, I mean, people have sex, and like snowflakes, no two people are the same. And if you're writing well, you take that into account. There's interiority there. I try and make the people, even if they're two-dimensional, really complexly two-dimensional. You know, guy drinks piss, three words. I have drunk piss on a variety of occasions, and once again, you know, those experiences are not identical. And, you know, after this, at this point, I try and get in there and explore those differences. The bad sex is as interesting as good sex, for instance.
I really kind of what it comes down for me is like I would probably describe myself as a word whore, you know, as well. I love, like, you know, and I think that, but I think that a huge part of everything for a huge part of it for me is finding the story in the places where people don't think that there's a story, or even more so where there is not supposed to be a story. I mean, a good example. There was a Richard Pryor stand-up that I was listening to as a little kid, and it was just about farting. And it was just, I was just fascinated at the idea of he even going there, him saying stuff about, what does the Pope sound like? Farting. I wonder if Jacqueline Kennedy farts. And he's like, Mrs. Kennedy Onassis, blah, blah, blah. And he does this whole thing. And it was this, I was just fascinated with that as, you know, because it was funny, but it was like, you're not supposed to do that. You're not supposed to say that. So, and not just about being what people would consider, you know, crude, but it's just like about let me go there and find and see wherever it is that I'm not supposed to go and see if there's an interesting idea there wherever it is.
So what I find, and this is especially when I'm writing erotica, is that what's interesting to me is not just the sex act itself. I mean, there are certain sex acts that push my buttons, and, you know, if you read my porn, you'll see certain sex acts crop up over and over again. But what's interesting to me is how do people feel about the sex that they're having? You know, how does it feel physically? And that's not always the same, you know, even if the physical act is the same. How does it feel emotionally? What does this sex mean to them? What is the history going into this sex? Is their life going to be different now because they had this sex? Somebody once pointed out that they were reading my erotica collection, and they said, you know, your stories often don't have closure. They don't have neat endings. You know, it kind of seems like it's not so much that they just end, but they kind of end with these open doors. And I realized that a lot of what I like to write when I'm writing erotica is, okay, this person is now going to be different because they had this sex, but I kind of want to leave it open. How exactly is this going to be different? You know, so, you know, like other people here have said, you know, no two people or three people or five people, depending on, you know, or one person, you know, depending on what kind of sex you're writing about, are the same. You know, we're not even the same, you know, year to year, day to day. You know, we're different people. And so trying to, you know, I wrote a piece once about how I write porn, and I said that I made this analogy that the sex act is like the skeleton, and the feelings and emotions, you know how the sex felt to people is like the flesh, and that the meaning, you know, what does this sex mean to them? Why are they having it? You know, what is driving it? That's like the nerves, and that I always try to make sure I have a good balance, because if it's too much just what it means, then it's not hot. And if it's too much just description of sex acts, then that's usually actually fairly boring. So yeah, but you know, it isn't just about, you know, tab A and slot B. It's, you know, whatever those tabs and slots might be. You know, people are almost endlessly fascinating, and people are really interested in sex. And so, you know, what drives people to have sex is just complicated and interesting. How are we for time? We have about four minutes. Okay. Do we have any questions from the virtual audience at this point?
No.
Okay. Any other questions from the live audience? I'm sorry. What?
Okay. So actually, I was writing you right before the performance, and saying, well, my piece is kind of like postmodern. It doesn't really have a resolution or a super, you know, very palpable, sort of a very clear arc. But I think that, so I don't really write commercial erotica anymore. But my first sort of major foray into erotica was a book in 2007, and it was dealing with an obsession that I had, which at the time I very strongly identified as a breast fetishist, and I got off thinking exclusively about breasts for many, many years. And it was really sort of pouring all of that obsession into stories. There were like 15 different stories that were all about breasts. And you know, and when you're obsessed with something, it has all of these nuances and details that, you know, the outside, maybe the non-obsessive, doesn't really understand. And that was why I really wanted to write the book, was to really sort of give somebody an in into the brain of a fetishist, and what that looks like. So it's really unusual. But in terms of, my relationship to erotica has changed a lot, because I mostly use it now as kind of a tool for sort of healing for me. And I often use it as kind of a tool when I'm working at universities or whatever, where we'll do transformative justice-oriented erotica, where I will push students to focus themselves in the work, you know, and their assignment is to re-envision themselves as desired, you know, which for a lot of people is really impossible, and that they are the subject of the erotica, and that a particular body part they have a difficult time loving is the focal point of the work. And it's like this totally transformative thing where and for some people, again, this is totally unusual. And since I do most of my work in body image related stuff, it really So anyway, I use the same kind of framework when I'm writing. It's mostly for me to process the various kinds of experiences I've had. And you know, with this one, like my extreme experience with Pentecostalism and feeling imprisoned in a lot of ways, and how I learned how to negotiate and strategize as like a young woman of color in a largely white church, and as a pervert in a largely like not, you know, pervert phobic world or something.
That seemed like a pretty good thing to end it on. If we have any time for any more questions, I guess not. Thanks again for coming out for our first live stream. Thank you, Internet, for coming out here. And you can catch more of us on a quarterly basis when it comes. You can find out about it at godlessperverts.org.
Find out more, godlessperverts.com. We have a website where we announce all of our other events. We also usually announce our live events through the Bay Area Atheist Meetup. We tweet at Godless Perverts. We have a Facebook page. And also, if you follow pretty much any of the organizers, me, David Fitzgerald, or Chris Hall, once again, big thanks to Chris Hall for doing tech. Awesome. So, you know, it's a thankless job, so thank you. If you follow us, any of the three of us on Facebook or Twitter, you'll find out about our stuff. And one more huge shout out to the Center for Sex and Culture. Shout out for them too. They actually left the Safe Sex poster display up for, they were going to take it down a couple days ago, and they left it up for a couple of days so we could have it as a backdrop. Thanks for them to doing that. Again, plug for the Safe Sex Bang, which is the exhibition catalog. And thanks to all of you for coming out, and thanks to all of you on the internet for watching.
Stay perverted.